The Avro Canada CF-100 Canuck was a great achievement for the Canadian aerospace industry and established Canada as a major aerospace power. During its production, several advanced variants were proposed to further enhance its capabilities. This took the form of new weapon systems and a few radical airframe modifications. Some were tested and others never made it off the drawing board. For a more complete discussion about the history and deployment of the CF-100, check out my video called The Avro Canada CF-100 Canuck. Here we will discuss some of the advanced variants not covered in that video. While this is not a complete list, it does cover the major proposals. First, we'll look at the weapon systems proposed for the Canuck that would have greatly enhanced its effectiveness as an interceptor. The Velvet Glove was a Canadian-designed and produced semi-active radar-guided missile. A Mark III Canuck was modified to carry four of them in pylons just outside and underneath the engine shroud. Later, a Mark V would be modified to carry the Sparrow II missile, which was under joint American-Canadian development. Many test firings of both missiles were conducted in the late 1950s. Although neither missile made it into active service, the tests were valuable for collecting data and experience that would be used on later projects. A more complete overview of these missile programs can be found in my video called The Velvet Glove Missile, A Beginner's Guide to Post-War Aerial Combat Weaponry. Other missile systems available at the time were proposed to outfit the Canuck. These included the Sidewinder, a rear aspect heat-seeking missile, and the smaller Falcon, which came in two versions. One was heat-seeking and the other was a semi-active radar-guided model. The Sidewinder would be mounted on pylons beneath the wing roots and associated systems would be installed in the cockpit. The Falcons were mounted on similar pylons. The Canuck would be able to deploy both variants of the Falcon, and so the ventral weapons bay was occupied with its associated equipment. Both the Sidewinder and Falcon were short-range missiles, and so still necessitated a certain degree of dogfighting, to which the Canuck was generally ill-suited for. The American company, the Bendix Corporation, designed a long-range radar-guided missile called the Eagle in 1957. This missile would have enabled interceptions at ranges of 200 to 300 kilometers, much greater than with other systems. The substantial size and weight of the missiles required designers to mount them on the wingtips. Associated systems were installed in the ventral weapons bay. The missile was eventually canceled in 1960 without any hardware having been tested outside of wind tunnels. The Canuck was also able to be equipped with a nuclear option. The Genie was an unguided rocket with a 1.5 kiloton warhead and could reach out to a range of 10 kilometers. The rockets were mounted on the wingtips, similar to the Eagle. Although never tested on the CF-100, the Genie would go on to arm the CF-101 Voodoo interceptors guarding the northern approaches into Canadian airspace. In addition to weapon systems, there were also some attempts to expand the capabilities of the aircraft through radical airframe redesign. In 1967, a Mark V Canuck was temporarily modified with a third turbofan engine mounted underneath the center of the airframe. This was done to test a new engine design called the JT-15D by the United Aircraft of Canada, who would later become Pratt & Whitney Canada. This variant was never intended to become an operational model and was done purely for research purposes. A drastic redesign of the basic layout came in the form of the proposed CF-100 Mark X variant. The Mark X, or Mark 10, would attain higher speeds and altitudes by doubling the number of engines. Four British-built Orpheus engines would replace the two Orenda engines in the fuselage and add two more on the wingtips. These engines were 2.8 meters long, weighed 385 kilograms, but each produced 224 newtons of thrust. This was somewhat impressive performance for its time. Originally, the wings were to be extended by 2.74 meters and strengthened to accommodate the new engines. The tail wing was also redesigned and swept back for increased performance at higher speeds. The Mark 10 was to be equipped with four Sparrow missiles. No prototypes were produced and the proposal was abandoned. NATO countries recognized the vulnerabilities of airfields in the case of an all-out war. The ability to operate from unprepared airfields, roads, and fields was sought as an operational requirement for all future aircraft. While rocket-assisted takeoffs were experimented with on roads and short airfields, it didn't fully address the problem. a vertical takeoff and landing version was proposed. The design was way ahead of its time and was practically a different aircraft. The main fuselage weight was reduced by 3,900 kilograms by eliminating the radar and the fire control system, the center fuel systems, and the rear cockpit seat. In addition to this, the engines were replaced by two Bristol Orpheus BE-53-2 engines. Thrust from the engines was vectored downwards during VSTOL flight from vents in the front and rear of the engine nacelles. Puffer vents on the wingtips, nose, and tail would be connected through an autopilot to provide control at low speed and during vertical flight. The forward thrust vents would close during forward flight while the rear was vectored horizontally. Armament for the fighter seems to be short-range heat-seeking missiles. This would have probably been the best low-weight option available. This design, too, was never pursued past the pen and paper stage. Design work on the Canuck was abandoned when the company oriented itself towards the production of the Aero. The last production variant would remain the Mark V, and they would serve the RCAF until their complete retirement in 1981.